Everything?
Yes.
Okay, the kitchen was renovated in 1957 because the floor was falling out. So, but we kept the original window frames and everything else. So, modern kitchen, and what we did to the bathroom, we took a bedroom and we just moved the partition wall down. So we got a very big, beautiful bathroom and a beautiful kitchen. So it's a very comfortable summer house. We lived there for 5 months.
When you say they're not load-bearing walls, is it because it's a balloon room?
No. Well, a half-timbered house does not have bearing walls, okay? Because you've got, if you go into Cossett House or into Jost House, you'll see why. You've got big beams up on the side and big beams running across. So the walls do not support the ceiling. Got it?
Yeah. Yes.
The inside walls, yes. Excuse me.
Yes.
Yeah. So, make sense?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Ken, what about that addition to the back of the
house?
The southern, the south thing. It's connected, you know, like, you know how over in the west coast, in Shetty Camp, because of the winds, they used to tie those pieces into the house. Was that a similar thing there or just convenience?
I think it's a very similar thing. That house, in every hurricane you get, it doesn't affect it at all.
Yeah.
There's lots of trees behind there in the hill, and the wind just comes in and sweeps up and over the house. So a northeast wind, a north wind, there's hardly any exposure on the north side. So they really knew what they're doing. They're passing on these traditions.
Well, you were talking about how they would
align the house, yeah. Like Daniel McKean, who's here tonight, has mentioned to me, when you fly over Ingonish, all the houses, the trees come right up to the back of the house. Everything is pointing south or southeast, you know what I mean? And I walk along the beach and I see this big, beautiful house. I don't know, let's say it's $400,000 cottage. And there's no windows on the southern exposure. I said, holy smokes. You know, that's lack of knowledge by somebody building that house.
Yeah.
You know, where it just makes no sense, right? Because you don't you want the sun?
Yeah.
I can't get enough sun.
Yeah.
Enough light, right? I don't care if it's winter, whatever. Like when the time shift takes place, I love it. More light, the better.
Is it the oldest house in England?
Well, historians don't like to use words like the oldest and the deepest and the biggest, because as soon as you do, somebody's going to prove you're wrong. So it may sound like a cop-out, but I'd say it's certainly one of the oldest. But I will say this, it's the oldest house in the best shape, in the best condition. How's that sound?
Yeah.
And I'll say, Marianne, it's definitely one of the oldest. Okay. And I'll tell you, it's going to be registered at municipal and provincial heritage level. It's going to have a first class scholarly paper published on it. And it's going to live on if I have anything to do with it, because I'm leaving it to my son and there's going to be money to go with it. Hopefully he won't need it. But it's in better shape now than it's ever been, I'd say. You know, probably in the 1850s or 60s. We have electric heat in every room of that house. And as it gets colder, we did what Loretta and her family did. So like coming on late September, we'll only heat the dining room and the kitchen and the bathroom. And upstairs, when we go to bed, we'll go up and turn on the electric heat, you know, half hour beforehand. And so you heat the rooms individually. So, you know, rather than heat the whole house and it just goes out, because there's no insulation, none, zip, none. But you see the reasoning behind it? We're not going to live there full time, and if you pack in the insulation, it makes it too tight. Can't breathe. So that's why in your modern day homes, like, I hate to tell you this, but there is moisture lurking.
And you're very close to the park.
Yes.
Are there any stories related to losing it?
Yes, all kinds. And I have I've been interviewing people, and I've got tons of evidence, and I'm going to write about this. But this man owned most of the Clyburn Valley, an awful lot of it, and he lost it. He was expropriated. And GWR Creighton, who I interviewed three times and did the expropriation in 1936, said, "I felt sorry for old Mr. James Donovan, and I tried to get him a better settlement." And he hired a lawyer, and he got double his settlement, but the lawyer took the extra half. Doesn't that sound familiar? God love lawyers. When you need them, they're very important. Don't begrudge lawyers anything, but it just so happened. He said he felt very sorry for him.
But were there similar houses like yours there lost through the building of the park?
Yeah, a lot of intersecting gable houses. There were about 30 homes expropriated to make way for the golf course and that part of Ingonish. And many of the elderly people had to move away because their sons and daughters didn't have room to take them in. And so I got all kinds of evidence of that. So a lot of heartbreak and heartache. You know, nobody likes to lose their home, right? You don't.
Ken, I'm one of those lawyers. Someone came to me a few years ago, and they were still trying to fight that. Do you know anything about that? Is that still going on? There's some people that are still... Have you heard about that up there? People are still...
Yes, I have, yeah. And... it's a tough hoe to fight. Well, I know there's very good cases of injustice.
Yeah.
And I know it, even in the 1970s, and I've got it documented.
Even in Lewisburg?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. So, when people want things, and by the way, the government, federal government, does not expropriate houses to create national parks anymore after Jackie Vautour.
Yeah.
You know, Jackie Vautour still lives in Coushubraquac,
yeah.
And there's been a scholarly book published on him by Ronald Rudan, and an award-winning film, too. So if you want to read about it, it's quite a story.
Interesting, yeah. I remember Jackie. Yeah. So,
but they don't do it anymore.
Good.
Uh-uh.
They're learning a lesson.
I think so, you know what I mean? But it took a lot of toll on people, right? So...
That balloon framing that you talk about, as a telephone man, we loved it. You could drill a hole upstairs and drop something right to the basement.
Yeah,
but the fire marshals aren't too happy with it.
No, fire marshals are not happy.
That wall that goes right to the attic.
Could everybody hear what Al said?
No,
Al, could you just let them hear? Speak up and let them know what you said.
The balloon framing was great for the electricians and the telephone men.
Oh.
You could drop a wire from the attic right to the basement without a problem.
Wow.
But the fire went the other direction. It started in the walls anywhere, so it went right to your roof. The house was gone.
So that's one reason to be afraid of fires, right?
Mm-hmm.
And but don't you love that expression? No stronger than a balloon. Got that? Now, do you have that tonight? Balloon frame and half timber? Got it?
Yeah.
Good. John?
I was going to ask you about door frames, internal and external.
Yes.
First about the height, and the one observation I make about the front of the house is that door is not, the windows are not symmetrically about that door.
I believe every word of that, and there's a lot of things that were crooked in that house. And my brother-in-laws did the work, and they said, ooh, this house is hard to work with. And because, well, for one thing, it sagged over, right? It's almost 200 years old. So you're going to have a lot of sagging. So we did a little bit of jacking up to straighten it, but you don't want to do too much. You know, you want it just right. Huh? But they were not great carpenters. But I can tell you this, John, I know a lot about the framing. Not everybody could frame a house. There were very similar style houses in Ingonish, and the framers came from St. Anne's. They came down, they said, cut your pine a year before and let it dry. And they would come back a year later and they would frame it. Now, for the rest of the carpentry work, they weren't great framers, and you've got a sharp eye and you're pointing it out. But by golly, it seemed to work. And as for the height of the doors, they're all shorter. People are taller today. You know why? Too much protein. And being tall is not necessarily a great thing. You keep eating protein, see what's going to happen. You're going to grow through the roof. Third joke for tonight.
How do you call that mustache over the windows and the door? Do you have a name for that before?
Yeah, I used to know that, but it's, isn't it great? Those little things, we reconstructed those exactly as they were. No?
No, you
just, no, that little thing.
No, I'm asking Daniel.
Oh, Daniel. Daniel would know. I don't want to put him on the spot. But first of all, I want to thank you very much for coming out on such a cool night. Okay? Thank you very much.